live in the shelter of the Most High, and who abide in the shadow of the Almighty will say to the Lord, you're my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. Sing with me.
The shelter of the Most High,
and who abide
in the shadow of the Almighty,
will say to the Lord that you're my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. The word of God says a thousand may fall
At my side,
even 10,000 may fall.
At my right hand,
but with my eyes,
I will only look.
For
it won't come near me. My hiding place.
The word says,
those who love me, I'll deliver. When they call me, I will answer. Protect those who know my name.
Slow about his promise, as men will think. Whatever he said about you shall surely come to pass. It's just that one day is 1,000 years to the Lord, and 1,000 years is like one day to the Lord. So whatever the case, he will come through for you. Hallelujah. Can we sing again? You who live in the shelter, come on.
Shelter of the Most High,
who abide
in the shadow of the Almighty,
will say to the Lord that you're
my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust.
I will only look.
It won't come near me.
That will tell you a lie. Neither is he the son of man that he will change his mind. His word is true, and his promises are yea and amen, and it shall bring you to an expected end. You know what? The boundary line shall fall for you in pleasant places, because you have a goodly heritage. Because the Lord your God is your strong tower.
You're welcome to International House of Virtue, the I Church. We are innovative, international, industrious, interdenominational, informed, interdependent, and inspirational.
To express our love for Jesus this morning. Wherever you are, if you want to lift your voice and sing along with us. If you love Jesus, lift your voice and give a blessing. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus, yeah. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done. In his arms, I feel protected. In his arms, never days connected. No, no, no. In his arms, I feel protected. There's no place I'd rather be. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done. Falling in love, falling in love, falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done. In his arms, I feel protected. In his arms, never disconnected. In his arms, I feel protected. There's no place I'd rather be. In his arms, yeah. In his arms, I feel protected. In his arms, never disconnected. No, in his arms, I feel protected. There's no place I'd rather be. Let your voice and begin to bless the name of the Lord, yeah. Father, we love you, Jesus. We give you praise, oh God. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. Thank you, Lord, for providing for us. Thank you, Lord, for keeping us. Thank you, Lord, for preserving us, oh God. Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. The best thing I've ever done. In his arms. I feel
protected.
In his arms. Never disconnected. No. In his arms, I feel. There's no place I'd rather be. In his arms, yeah. I feel in his arms. Never disconnected. No. In his arms I feel protected. There's no place I'd rather be. There's no place I'd rather be. I enjoy his presence, yeah. There's no place I'd rather be. For the length of my days, I will be in his presence. There's no place I'd rather be. So falling in love with Jesus, yeah. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done. Hallelujah.
How is everybody?
Fine.
Wow. So good to see you all. You're all looking beautiful. God bless all of you. We are so thankful for this opportunity to be here. I'm just thinking about 2 years ago, you know, when we started this journey and how faithful the Lord has been. I remember that day, that morning, when the Lord, you know, he had been talking to us for a number of times. It's been a journey. But I remember a particular day, and I remember the word that he said. And as I'm standing here and saying, God is faithful. He's so faithful. He's so faithful. He's a good God. I want to bless his name this morning. I'll just start with a short time of prayer, and then we'll take it up from there. So, our Father and our God, we thank you so much for today. Father, we are in awe of you this morning. We thank you, O Lord, for your mercy. We thank you for your grace. We thank you, O Lord, for your faithfulness. We thank you, Lord, for 2 beautiful years. We thank you, Lord, for how far you have brought us. We pray in the name of Jesus that in this service, Father, you will manifest yourself unto us. That in this service, Lord, because we are here, because we've been obedient, Father, we shall be blessed. Your word says that no one, Jesus, comes into your presence and leaves the same. So, Father, our belief and our hope is that today we'll not leave here the same. Today, our light, the light that you have put in us, O Lord, will shine even brighter. We thank you for your presence, Holy Spirit. Thank you for your love. We thank you for your provision. We thank you for all the lives gathered here, and even those who are watching us online. May your name be praised today and forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So why are we gathered here? Who knows why we are gathered here?
Yeah? So we are... It's been two wonderful years. I want you to give a scream, to give a shout of praise to the name of God. People see us and then they wonder. It has not been easy. You know, it has not been easy, but the Lord has been with us. When the Lord is with you, things that appear easy are made, things that are difficult are made easier. Amen. So we invite Daddy Makafui to give us. Lead us in a time of praise. Hallelujah. I am excited. I don't know about you.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. God deserves our thanksgiving. He deserves our praise. We want to go before him this morning with songs of worship. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then we praise him right after. Hallelujah. Let's be upstanding. We praise thy name, O Lord. 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 Lift your voice and sing. We praise thy name. Yeah.
You are great, Jesus. You are great, Jesus. We serve a great God. He is so great. He is so great. You are great. We love you, Jesus. We worship and adore. Lift up your voice in this place. Lift your voice. We are celebrating the goodness of God. You want to count the blessings and appreciate God for all he's done and all he's about to do, all he's doing. Oh, Jesus, be exalted, be enthroned in this place. We worship you, love of God. Jesus, thank you, Lord. Thank you for 2 years of your goodness. Thank you for all the blessings, the provision. Thank you for your spirit in this church. Thank you for your grace. We honor you, Lord. We honor you, Jesus. We honor you, Jesus. We honor you, Jesus. Father, be enthroned.
Jesus, Jesus, eh, hami, dana, Jesus, Jesus, eh.
Lift your voice.
Jesus, 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 eh, eh, yeah. Jesus, oh, he's good, he's good, he's good.
Good. He's good. He's good. Just wave your hands to him. This place. I feel his presence all around here. He is good and he's with us. We thank you, Lord. We honor you. We honor you. You are good. You are good. You are good. In all the saints, lift your voice and shout. Amen.
Amen.
Come on, clap your hands, all you people. Clap your hands, all you people. Come on. One more, yes, you will say, yeah. Yeah.
Never, Sinaye, 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 praise in this place. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
It's been two awesome years. Amen.
Amen.
And we give God praise. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Perfect in all your ways. For the rest of my days, I will chase after you. So I will sing of mercy and tell of your loving kindness. And I will tell everybody just how good you will be to
what an awesome God you are.
Yes, you are.
Wow. God is good. That was powerful. I was sitting down thinking that this is Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir Standard. Then you kind of reminded me that this is the high church. Gifty, can I pray for you? Lord, I ask, oh God, that you who know the intents of the heart, may you plant the seed of a song in your servant. That song that births a unique ministry. May it be said of you that she is the Lord's minstrel. Receive that grace. Songs in the night, and by day may your voice echo through the nations. May your songs be as beautiful as your children. Thank you, Lord. There's been one desire
Jesus.
That's it. Every jar shall be filled with wine. Today, my wife and I are speaking to you. It doesn't normally happen, does it? You're all welcome. I can see all of you on, I can see Roger, I can see Araba, I can see Justice. I can see Kwokwai waving at me with her auntie Naode and family Okan, Penny Dixon, Jell, Beatrice, Doreen. Wow, it's powerful, isn't it? Hey, my wife, don't go and leave me. Let's get out.
It is powerful.
Akra and our tea spirit. As well, God is good. So every jar shall be filled with wine. Say amen.
Amen.
And we are jars of clay. But you see, when the Holy Spirit enters that jar, suddenly, that same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead will quicken your mortal body. And today marks the beginning of another outpouring. The outpouring.
Outpouring.
We're going to read two pieces of scripture. I'll read from the Old Testament and my wife will read from the New Testament. Isn't it? It doesn't mean OT. But it means that they work together to complete each other. Amen.
Amen.
And as she gets ready to do hers, I'll read mine. And I'm excited to see Jane. Jane, how are you? Wow. There's only one Jane. Mask or no mask, I'll see you. And Mrs. Hope is in the house. Mrs. Mifitu. Today when I saw her, I said, Charlie, your husband is taking good care of you. There's no art to find the mind's construction on the face. I didn't know this man was romantic. Never. He doesn't even hold the bass guitar romantically. But suddenly some things are happening. Have you seen his watch? Hey.
God is good.
It is well. May you also receive grace.
Amen.
To get a good wife.
Amen.
Every jar shall be filled. I'm reading from Jeremiah 13. And today will be special because we'll climax it with communion. It's going to be beautiful.
Amen.
Jeremiah 13. And then my wife is reading from
John 15, 1 to 8.
Good. So I'll read mine and then she'll read hers and then we begin. Thus says the Lord to me, go and buy a linen loincloth and put it around your waist and do not dip it in water. So I bought a loincloth according to the word of the Lord and put it around my waist. And the word of the Lord came to me a second time. Take the loincloth that you have bought, which is around your waist, and arise, go to the Euphrates and hide it there in the cleft of the rock. So I went and hid it by the Euphrates, as the Lord commanded me. And after many days, the Lord said to me, arise, go to the Euphrates and take from there the loincloth that I commanded you to hide there. Then I went to the Euphrates and dug, and I took the loincloth from the place where I had hidden it. And behold, the loincloth was spoiled. It was good for nothing. Then the word of the Lord came to me, thus says the Lord, even so will I spoil the pride of Judah and the great pride of Jerusalem, this evil people who refuse to hear my words, who stubbornly follow their own heart and have gone after other gods to serve them and worship them, shall be like this loincloth, which is good for nothing. For as the loincloth clings to the waist of a man, so I made the whole house of Israel and the whole house of Judah cling to me, declares the Lord, that they might be for me a people, a name, a praise, and a glory, but they will not listen. You shall speak to them this word, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, every jar shall be filled with wine. Amen. And they will say to you, do we not indeed know that every jar will be filled with wine? Interesting people. Let's hear from John.
So John chapter 15, verses 1 to 8, the true vine. So these are Jesus' words. They are marked in red. If your Bible is like mine. I am the true vine, and my Father is a vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine and you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. So you will be my disciples. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Let's Amen. Pray. Father, may the words of our mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord our God and our Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Great. So I want to first thank all our speakers who came earlier. We started with Pastor Helen Yorson. Very, very powerful delivery. You know, blessed, shifted us into another dimension. And my own friend, Reverend Dr. Solomon Norte came and took us to the epikaizo level, right? And last week... last week, all the way from New Jersey, it was fire. You know, the three levels of relationships, you know, and I trust that none of us is at the roadside by now, because we are moving from the roadside into the home with our God. And we are moving deeper into a point of revelation. Amen. So I was asking myself, hey, Lord, after all these powerful people, what else are we going to tell your people? But thank God for his grace and mercy. Amen.
Amen.
God says every jar shall be filled with wine. Amen. So if you go to Jeremiah, I'll be dwelling on the Jeremiah bit, and then she would, you know, come from John. Jeremiah, John Rollins. It is well. Thus says the Lord to me, go and buy a linen loincloth and put it around your waist. You know what a loincloth is? You see, when the wrestlers, sumo wrestlers, you know what a sumo wrestler is? Do you know where a sumo wrestler is? Those fat Japanese people who, when they are fighting, they do this. They have this thing they put around their, you know, their precious things. And that's all they wear. Is the closest thing to the body. You understand? And so, when you see somebody's loincloth, it means that you've seen his sweat. You've seen him. I'm talking to adults here. There are certain things when you are not married, you will not do. You will not wash your brother's underwear. Will you? But when you marry, you'll be baptized. I'm preaching. Because suddenly there's nothing hidden anymore. So that was the loin. God said, get a loin and tie it around your waist. And do not dip it in water. And so he bought the loincloth. So you see, that loincloth becomes a precious thing that you can't share with anybody else. And it simply signifies that we've been bought with a price. A very high price. Because we are an intimate part of God's workmanship. We've been bought with a price. He said, buy it and tie it around your waist. And it signified God's relationship with the Jews. That is the loincloth. Other clothes you can remove, you can pass on to somebody, but not the loincloth. If I'm sharing my things and they give you my that way, you feel insulted, isn't it? That why? But my wife, if I go before her, she said, no, don't throw those ones out. Those are mine. You understand? Those are mine. That's why the young men, you wake up one day and your wife is wearing your boxer shorts. Has it happened to you yet? It's a mystery. You will understand it. But just to build, you see, we've been bought with a price. We are precious to God. We are his loincloth. We are what? His loincloth. So let me pause here and let's hear what John has to say.
So, already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. We are clean because of the word of God that we've heard. There are many people out there who, because they haven't heard the word, they are not clean. And that is why, even as Christians, it is very important that we take the word out there. But this word actually comes for those of us who are in the house of God. We are clean because we have heard his word. See, the word of God is all that we need. I have said that to myself many times. The word of God is all I need. All I need is the word. All you need is the word. Without the word, you have nothing. In Psalms, David said that, thy word have I hidden in my heart, that I will not sin against you. How are we able to maintain that intimacy with Christ without his word? Like Pastor Annie was talking about, we are his loincloth. We are intimate with him. How are we able to maintain that intimacy without the word of God? Many Christians are going about these days without the word. They think they are okay without the word. But without the word, you have no relationship. Without the word, there's no intimacy. Without the word, there's no relationship. Amen. And people feel that they can actually, you know, so we hear the word, we come into Christ, we are branches and he's the vine, and then suddenly we think that we can do it without the word. It's not possible. It's not possible. So the word of God is all that we need. It's all that we have. So it's very, very important that we continue to meditate on the word of God. We continue to let the word shape our lives. Okay, we continue to let the word prune us. Because we also have to grow. Hallelujah.
Amen. So you realize that he said, don't dip the loincloth in water. You understand? You don't, because when you attach to me, you're already clean. He is the word. So it's by our attachment to him that makes us clean. You don't need Florida water. You don't need any Ebura Munsio. You don't need anything else to clean you up. It is the word of God that you need. You need to abide in him. And that's where he says that you are already clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. So he continues and says, take the loincloth that you have bought around you and go to the Euphrates and hide it there. And after many days, arise, go and take it. And when he went there, he realized that it was spoiled. It was spoiled. It was spoiled. It was spoiled. After many days, after he has separated the loincloth from his waist and put it near the Euphrates, when he went back there, that loincloth was what? Spoiled. So we fall apart when we refuse to hear his word. And do you know how we refuse to hear his word? Offense. We are offended at many things. If Jesus was offended whilst he was here, he would not go to the synagogue. Because he knew the minds of the people. But the Bible said, as was his custom, he always went to hear the word of the Father. Apart from me, you can do nothing. That's what he said. So he said, we fall apart when we refuse to hear the word. When the loincloth was separated from him, it got spoiled. If you think things are spoiling for you, check who moved. Check your daily activities. Check your routine. It's the devil's plan to separate you and spoil you. When people are telling you things that separate you from the people of God, know that they are leading you to destruction. We fall apart when we refuse to hear the word. We also fall apart when we follow our own hearts. You see, we follow our own heart. The Lord said what? These evil people who refuse to hear my words, who stubbornly follow their own hearts, have gone after other gods to serve them and worship them. For some of us, when there's something that we want, we rather put God second, forgetting that when we seek first the kingdom and its righteousness, all other things that we are looking for will be given to us. Have you seen a young woman who is getting ready to get married? You say, hello, what are you saying? I don't want to do the response. People think I'm preaching about them. I'm not preaching about anybody. Their preoccupation is about wanting to get married. But you see, the more you get close to the Lord, the more he prepares a suitor for you.
True.
Oh, it's an amazing thing. It's an amazing thing. We become good for nothing when we separate ourselves from the Lord. The loincloth meant something special because it was tied to the waist of Jeremiah. When it was taken away from his waist, it became good for nothing. You see, you and I, we have a place in the kingdom. We are special. They say we are gifted. They call us just because of our attachment to Christ. When we separate from Christ, we are nothing. There's nothing you have that they are really looking out there for. It's some grace, adum binti, and the adum is based on your relationship with Christ. So separate yourself from Christ, you are nothing. When you are separated from your source, you begin to waste away. You become what? Good for nothing.
So, then Jesus said again, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. When I saw the word true vine, then it just occurred to me that if there's a true vine, then there's probably a false. If there's a true vine, then there's probably a false vine. You see, Jesus says that he is a true vine, and we are the branches. There are so many people who are attached to vines that are not Jesus Christ. So you ought to ask yourself that question. What vine am I attached to? If Jesus said that I am the true vine, it means that other people are also posing as vines. And there are branches who are also attached to other vines, thinking that they are attached to Jesus Christ. But he's the true vine. So you better look for him and get attached to him. The truth of the matter is that we are not even the ones who are looking for him. He's the one actually who is looking for us. So then the statement should be, you should open up to him. You should accept him. Hallelujah. He says that I am the true vine, and then you are the branches. It says, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he will take away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that he may bear more fruit. So the first step, we are the branch. It is, like I said earlier, it's important that you are attached to the true vine. So it means that to start the conversation, if you are not attached to this true vine at all, then this conversation is not even for you. Because there's no way you are going to bear any fruit if you are not attached to the vine to start with. Okay? So now you are attached to the vine. If you are not bearing fruit, the Bible says that he says he will cast you away. Are we bearing fruit? Are we bearing fruit? The Bible says that if we bear fruit, he prunes us. What does pruning mean? I tried to get to the dictionary to understand what pruning means. Pruning is about, you know, when you're growing a plant, you have dead twigs, dead leaves and stuff. That does not help the tree to grow. The Bible says that if you are not bearing fruit, the Lord will cast you away. But if you are bearing fruit, he prunes you. The pruning process is difficult. The pruning process is painful. But the end is that you're going to bear much fruit. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So we need to be able to for some people, when the pruning process starts, they are going through pruning, they are so uncomfortable because it's painful. And because of the pruning, they decide to want to detach themselves from the vine. How are you going to bear fruit if you are not attached to the vine? Hallelujah. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he says he will cast away. Hallelujah.
Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, I will cut away. So we either pruned or cut away. We either blossom or we wither. All is the choice that we have to make. And the choice is simple. Very simple. Just cling. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. It was the emblem of suffering and shame. But I love that old cross, where the dearest and best of a world of lost sinners was slain. And it's a chorus that I want to dwell on. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies, at last I lay down. I will cling to the old
rugged cross,
and exchange it someday. Now we are coming to the pivotal part of the message. It says, for as the loincloth clings to the waist of a man, so I made the whole house of Israel and the whole house of Judah and the whole house of the International House of Virtue cling to me, declares the Lord, that they might be for me a people, a name, a praise, and a glory. But they will not listen. Can you read what John is saying?
John is saying that if you abide in me and my words abide in you, he says, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. Amen.
Amen. So you see the King James Version and the New English Version. When the prophets are speaking in Old Testament, it's not for children. You have to ask for further revelation to understand. But when Jesus came, he made it very plain. He says, well, if you abide in me and my words abide in you. What was Jeremiah saying? For as a loincloth clings to the waist of a man. And Jesus is saying, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish. He says what? That they might be for me a people, a name, a praise, and a glory. So four things. Then Yah will continue. We manifest as a people by clinging. What did I say? We manifest as a people by clinging. Clinging to our source. When we are cut off from the source, then our manifestation is cut short. You become stillborn. Become mango boom. Do you know mango boom? You are plucked too early from the tree. And so you give sickness instead of giving pleasure. You give trouble instead of giving joy. You understand? But if you stay on the tree until you are ripe, oh, what a joy you will be to everybody who receives you. So when we cling, we manifest as a people. There are so many countries in this world. But there are some passports that are powerful. True or false? You know, some people are shy to tell you where they come from. But you see, when the Lord makes you a people, you are not shy anymore. You are bold to declare. But how would you be bold to declare if you don't go through the process? They call some people a failed state. Because they didn't allow the rule of law or the rule of Christ or the rule of the kingdom in their midst. And so there's anarchy. This person fighting against this person and killing everybody. And so they don't manifest as a people. But when they come together, I thank God for an example in Africa called Rwanda. Some 10 years ago, they were a failed state because Tutsis and Hutus were butchering each other. Today, when you go to Rwanda and you say, are you a Hutu? We will look at you funny. Because they've done away with the name Hutu and Tutsi. They've done away with that. That's why it's a shame that in this country, after all these years, we are still having tribal issues. It's a shame. It's a big shame. How do we manifest as a people like that? Let's cling to that common agenda, and that is where we'll manifest as a people. Because one part of the country cannot do it. We need every part of the country to manifest as Ghanaians. When we go to the World Cup, it's people from every part of the country. And when they play together, we all rejoice. So we need to manifest as a people, and it's by clinging. Not falling to factionism and what people want to say. Hallelujah. Number two, we manifest a name. We manifest what? A name. That is God's idea. Put a loincloth around you so that you will bear my name. When you don't have a name, you seek for titles. What I'm going to say, I'll get trouble for it. You know, some schools have to add grades to their name in order for them to be accepted. You'll get into trouble. But when your school has a name, you don't need to add great to it. The name resounds, true or false?
True, true.
So God gives you a name, and then you don't need a title. You don't need to be apostle, prophet, doctor, whatever. Because he's giving you a name. And there is a name. There is a name given to man by which, at the mention, every knee bows. So you see, throw away all, let all the names fade away, so that the name of Jesus will be exalted. Because that's what makes us special. If we are manifesting as a church, it's because the name of Jesus is on us.
Amen.
Yes, the name I Church is cool and all that. But what is I Church without Jesus?
Mm.
It's a shame. You say you belong to a big church and we have these branches. What is that church without Jesus? What is that nation without Jesus? We've been given a name. And when we cling, then that name makes us who we are supposed to be. We manifest the name. Three, we manifest as a praise to our God. That's the kind of manifestation we are talking about. When we say we are manifesting as a church, we manifest as a praise to our God. There are children who give praise to their parents, and there are children who are a reproach to their parents.
Merci.
No matter how far your parent has gone in life, it's like the worst thing that happened to them is their seed. Their children bring them such dishonor. That's why the Bible is very tough when it comes to honor your father and your mother, so that what your days may be long. God gives us what? We become a praise to our God. Like, because of you, people will say, oh, God be praised. When you manifest purpose, what you are supposed to be doing in this world, people praise God.
Mm.
You see, you are a designer. When people see your designs, say, "Chali, nyami wuhu." There's some people, when they cook for you, when you eat, oh, you praise God. But some other ones too. You'll be locked up in there somewhere, in the corner, in the somewhere. Releasing things. And how can you praise God? So when we manifest properly, we become a praise to our God. And when we say manifestation, these are the four things. As a people, we manifest the name. We manifest as a praise. And four, we manifest glory in clinging. He says what? That they might be for me a people, a name, a praise, and a glory. A people, a name, a praise, and a glory. Oh, God has blessed you. God, you know, and that is the manifestation we are talking about. So that is the era in which we've entered. I'm not saying we are entering. I said the era in which we've entered.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So finish up and then let me.
There's a place in God to ask whatever you wish. You know, when I read this, I get excited. And I'm sure many Christians get excited as well. It says, whatever you wish.
Hmm.
And we wish so many things. You know, if I asked us to write a list of the things that we wish, the books cannot contain. We wish for a lot of things. But the Bible says that there's a place in God where we can ask whatever we wish and then he'll give it to us.
Hmm.
We just read about it. It says that if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you ask what you desire and it shall be done for you.
Hmm.
So it means that we need to abide in Christ and let the word of Christ abide in us. That is the prerequisite for asking whatever you wish, and then it will be done for you. And I can understand that, because if you're, I don't know if you can understand that, but I can understand that, because Christ can
God can trust that if your word, if His word is abiding in you, whatever you are asking for is aligned to His will.
Mm.
Hallelujah. We ask so many things, and sometimes you complain that I've been praying about this thing for so long, but the Lord is not answering my prayer. But it's probably because His word is not abiding in you, and you're also not abiding in Him. Because if your word, if His word abides in you, and you're also abiding in Him, I make them sometimes, you know, then you even understand where you are with God, at which point you are. You understand what is next. What is next? If you are in an intimate relationship with somebody, you understand them. You know where you have gotten to. You know people are praying for marriages, people are praying for children, people are praying for jobs. But if He abides, if you abide in Him and His word abides in you, you even know at which time to be making that prayer.
Oh.
Because you see, when you are in that relationship with God, He's able to tell you about times and seasons. He just told me that this last week, that He's able to tell you about times and seasons. So sometimes we are praying certain prayers at certain times, and maybe it's not time for that prayer. We should be praying about something else. But because we are not abiding in Him and His word is not abiding in us, we are praying, they say we are praying amiss.
Mm.
And then we are hurt and we are complaining. But if you are in Him, you understand at every point where we are, because it's a journey. And sometimes we are praying certain prayers, not because that's a desire the Lord has placed in us, but we are looking at somebody and what the Lord is doing in that person's life. And then we are desiring the same things. And then we are praying, and then the answer is not coming. Then we are hurt, we are tired, we are withering away. But if we remain in Him, if we remain tied to His waist, then we understand where we have gotten to on the journey. I shared my story about the promotion I got from work. You know, I had been praying about it. But when it was time, I remember the Lord showed me a dream. He showed me a dream, and I realized that when I have prayed about it, I have asked, He's going to give me. But He's going to give me when the time is right, at the right time. So, and at that time, it didn't even look possible, because whoever I thought I was going to get the permission from at that point, the Lord showed me that that person was not going to be even in that position at the time I was going to get that promotion. He showed me this dream like 2 years before, and it happened. I remember I shared it with a couple of friends, because my boss was a lady, and in the dream, I entered her office. That was my boss's boss. I entered her office expecting to see her, but I saw somebody else. I saw a man I didn't even know. And 2 years later, you know, that lady had moved to MD, and I had a new director who was a man. It was that mother I had seen in the dream.
Hmm.
So the Lord was trying to tell me that, yes, I'll give you this promotion, but it's going to happen in 2 years. Meanwhile, I had been praying and crying and, you know, saying, Lord, but why? There was a time when I thought it was my turn. I had done all that was necessary. I was meeting my numbers. It was time to get that promotion. But it wasn't time. Hallelujah. So if we abide in Him and we allow His word to abide in us, the journey becomes more pleasurable, because you understand where you are. So you have to ask yourself, Lord, in this walk, because it's a walk, it's an intimate walk, we are walking with the Lord, where are we? Where have we gotten to? What is the next step? You don't determine the next step by looking at what the Lord is doing with somebody's life.
Oh.
Because it is a mutu, no? It is a relationship between you and Him. That's why He's saying that, He says, I'm the true vine and He are the branches. We are supposed to be stuck to Him. We are the cloth around His loins.
Yep.
You don't look at somebody and what He's doing with somebody to determine what your next step should be. Yes, sometimes there might be similarities, but each and every one of us have a unique relationship with the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Intimacy with God births manifestation. I like to talk about intimacy with God, because as I've always talked about it, there's nothing like intimacy with the Lord Himself. His love. He said three things remain: hope, faith, and love. But love is the greatest, because God is love.
Mm.
And what is intimacy without love? Without love, there's no intimacy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So if we remain in him and his word remains in us, that is intimacy. Intimacy is living your life knowing who you are and knowing whose you are. Intimacy is remaining in him every step of the way and letting his word direct your step, direct every decision that you make. That is intimacy. Intimacy, and especially as women, half the time, there's so many things going on in our minds. You see, but it's possible to have that intimate relationship with the Lord throughout the day. Like, I make it a point, anytime I sit in my car, I listen to maybe, I almost said Sunny FM. And sometimes people don't understand, why don't you listen to the news? No. Those are the little things that I can do during the day to remain connected to God. So every opportunity that I get, because I might not be able to wake up in like the night to pray sometimes like Pastor Neil will do, because he does that. I'm not able to do that all the time. So we need to find time during the day where you can continue to have that intimate conversation with the Lord. Anytime I sit in my car, I'm listening to gospel or I'm listening to a sermon. You know, when I'm walking, I'm talking to the Lord. We can do that. Some people can do that. But I'm always talking to him. I'm always chatting with him. That is intimacy. And when you have that, he tells you stuff. He tells you things. He tells you where you've gotten to. He tells you where you are going to go to. He reveals things to you. Hallelujah. Amen. Without the word of God, without abiding in him and allowing the word to abide in us, we can't have intimacy. Because the word of God is God, right? The word of God is Christ. So how are you able to have intimacy with him without the word? You can't. Then you'll be talking about something else, which is not him. Hallelujah. So we ought to remain intimate. It says, intimacy with God is what will birth our manifestation. And what are we manifesting to become? We are manifesting to manifest. I've used the same word twice. But we are trying to manifest that Christ. That's what we are trying to manifest. How are you able to manifest Christ without the word? Without that intimate relationship with him? They say that when two people are married for a long time, they begin to look alike. When people share my picture with Pastor Neil, you know, people come back and they say, you guys look alike. So I can't see it. Usually you say that
because she thinks it's beautiful that
I know, so
but me are different.
You know, but it's because we have worked together. It's because we are intimate with each other. You can, that's why you say, show me your friends and I'll show you. Yeah. You cannot walk with somebody and not begin to look like them. My mind just went back to, you know, those days in the garden where they came to try to capture Christ. When they got there, they couldn't even tell which of them Christ was, because the disciples had worked with him so much that they had begun to look like him. So are we beginning to look like Christ? That is the sort of manifestation that we are talking
That's
about
it.
Are we beginning to show love like Christ? These days sometimes Christians pray, says that let my word abide in you. We pray certain prayers that are not even aligned to the word of God, and we pray them confidently. It shocks me. Like, people pray and they are killing people, like in the prayer. I'm like, but the Bible clearly says, love your enemies. Where does that come in? When you go and say that, they are like, oh, yeah, like, but that is the word of God. So you cannot pray outside the word of God and then say you are intimate with him. That's not possible. You are lying to yourself. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So we ought to let the word of God abide in us, so that we can ask what we want, what we wish. Because at that point, whatever you're asking for is what even Jesus Christ is asking for you.
That's it.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then he will grant it. Amen. Proof of our discipleship is in our manifestation. And I think I spoke about that when I spoke about the disciples and Jesus Christ in the garden. You are a disciple when you begin to look like Christ. You know, you're a disciple when you begin to look like Christ. not when you merely just act like Christ. Because some are fixed to other branches and they're able to act out the way Christians act, but they don't look like him. They scream, they shout, but their very lives, the fruit of the Spirit, it's not, it doesn't show in them. So they are not disciples. They think they are. Well, sometimes we think we are, but we are not. You are truly a disciple when you begin to manifest the very nature of Christ. Hallelujah.
Amen. Isn't that powerful? Isn't that powerful? When I travel too long, this woman will take over the church. Don't you see? It is happening. It's a proof of our discipleship is in our manifestation. He said, a fruit doesn't fall too far from the tree. What shows that you're a disciple of Christ if you're not able to do the things that Christ does? Clearly, he says that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. The fruit that you bear will show whether you are a true disciple or a false disciple. There was one of the 12 who they later called the son of perdition. They called the thief. Meanwhile, Jesus had told us earlier who the thief was. He said he's a what? Good shepherd. But the thief, he comes to what? To steal, to kill, and to destroy. So one of them manifested that attribute. That's why they had to replace him. What attribute are you manifesting? Those who live with your parents, do your parents say, "Na asore no kra de na echem wo ho"? Because of what you are manifesting at home. Does your wife decide not to go to church anymore, or your husband, because of what you are manifesting at home? What are you manifesting? It's manifestation, but you can tell that it can come in various forms. People manifest some things and you are like, "I was shocked." What are we manifesting? But let me bring this whole thing to a perfect conclusion. Why I told you from the beginning that every jar shall be filled with wine. In the realms of the Spirit, the wine represents the Holy Spirit. The Lord said in Joel that in the last days I'll pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. There is an outpouring in these times. The sons of Issachar, they understand the times. And so they know the kind of prayers they should be praying around this time. While people are crying that some generals are leaving, the sons of Issachar are putting themselves in strategic positions for the next assignment. Because God just doesn't say farewell to one group and leave things in a vacuum. It means their assignments, their mantles, their mandates. And those who are ready, those who have clung to him, those who are in communion with him, understand what is happening, and they put themselves in readiness for what God is about to do. So yes, there's wine in every jar. But for some, the wine will cause them to be fighting each other. That's what Jeremiah said. He said, "Don't we know that there is wine in every jar?" We know. It was like a proverb in those days. But you see, for some, they'll get intoxicated with the wine, such that they'll be tearing each other apart, destroying each other. But those who are filled with good wine, and you know the good wine, when Jesus came, the very first miracle he performed, the Bible says he turned what? Water into wine. And the MC of that program said, "But who does that? Who reserves the good wine for the last minute? Normally you serve what? The good wine first. Not niakano. You know, they came late, so you know. But how come you've reserved the good wine? And here's the revelation. Our fathers of faith, Abraham, Moses, Elijah, Jeremiah, they all sought that wine. But in the fullness of time, the vine himself came. And he said, I'm leaving, but I'll not leave you as orphans. When I go, my Father will send the Comforter, the Holy Spirit. And we have received that good wine. We have been filled with the good wine. And that good wine is who enables us to will and to do according to God's good pleasure. We have the Holy Spirit. It's a promise that a lot of people were waiting for. They only got the epikaizo. Comes upon you, you do some amazing things, and then, you know. But he now lives in you. He lives in you. But do your deeds reflect that the Holy Spirit is in you? When the Holy Spirit is in you, certain things would have annoyed you. But because of the Holy Spirit, something on the in the inside is showing on the outside. Oh, what a change in my life, as the songwriter says. The Holy Spirit begins to now inform what you do, how you do, why you do, and all that. When Jesus says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, he's just trying to tell you that when the Holy Spirit comes to live in you, and you also pay heed to him, walking by the Spirit. Oh, that's when your will and your desire is aligned to the word of God, to God's plan for your life. And whatever you ask is what the Spirit will ask. That's when you pray certain mysteries and you are praying according to the will of God for the particular time. You wake up and you are declaring some things and you don't know that you just caused some power shift. Somebody says, I'm holding on to power. I'm not giving up. He wakes up the next day. God has already called him. Because some prayer warrior somewhere woke up and the Lord put a country in his mouth. And he begins to declare. And things change. We have power. We have dunamis. The power of the Holy Ghost. And when we get this wine, oh, you know, our lives become sweet. It's not that wine that intoxicates you, that makes a mockery of you. It's that wine that brings you good pleasure. Because in his presence, there's what? Fullness of joy. At his right hand, there's what? Pleasures evermore. You need a wine of the Holy Spirit. And today, symbolically again, and I'm about ending, we are going to have communion. Can you get that prepared for me? We are going to have communion. The word says, I'm the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. So he shall pour his Holy Spirit on all flesh. This morning, for some of you, it's going to be a rebirth. Because like my wife was saying, there's some growth that needs to be pruned away. There are some things that need to be pegged from your system. Some spiritual miscellaneous is going to happen when you take communion this morning. All the things that are inhibiting you from manifesting God's glory, you will flush them out. And you flush them out with all those other lingering growth and cancers and all sort of funny things in your system. If you are watching us online, tonight we are having a healing service. We call it Night of Virtue. Something amazing is going to happen and you don't want to miss that. 6 p.m. sharp, we are having it. You don't want to miss it. I just have to say that. But as they get ready and bring the communion, I want you to remember this. When Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread and broke it and gave thanks, the Bible said, he told them, do this in remembrance of me. Thank you. I have the best hospitality in the whole world. He said, what? Do this in remembrance of me. And I'm going to give you a revelation I caught recently. It's, I forget her name, one of these powerful, Cindy Trim, who was ministering. I caught that revelation. Do this what? In remembrance of me. And here it is. Remember is from two words. Re and member. So you're a member of something, but you can lose your membership. And so you have to be remembered, rejoined. So when Jesus says, anytime you do this, remember me, remember that you are part of me. Anytime you take this, remember that what? You are part of me. And when you are part of me, you won't do the things that I don't do. When you are part of me, you do the things that I do. The things that you see me do, you will do greater. So anytime, that's why of all the things he could leave us as a whale, he left us this. That as often as you do this, do it what? In remembrance of me. So anytime you take it, that should make you remember. And that is a revelation that last week, when the prophet was speaking, he said, as soon as they broke the bread, their eyes, what? Were opened. Because they broke the he broke the bread the way Jesus will break the bread. You understand? That he did many things. He said many things, but their eyes were, but as soon as he broke, because that was a secret thing. My wife said, he will tell you stuff. That was the stuff he told them on the night that he was betrayed. That as often as you do this, you remember me. You remember what I came to do. So anytime we have this symbolic, you know, sacrament, we remember Christ. We remember that we belong to him. We are remembered with him. We are rejoined to him. It doesn't matter if you've gone to join yourself to a harlot. You remember that you don't belong to her anymore. A superior blood has bought you. And so you are washed again by the word. And then you come and rejoin to him. Because you belong to him. That is why we do it together. That's why it's something that you should do with your family. It's something you are telling your family that we belong to Jesus. When you do that thing, it's an indication that we belong to Jesus. When somebody is on a sick bed and says, I want communion, the person feels alone, left alone. But the person says, come and give me, I belong to the body. I belong to the body. I belong to the body. I don't belong on my own. I belong to Jesus. And I'm going to join him. So please come and give me the communion. Some do it because of the religious thing, but there is a spiritual significance that I belong to Jesus. I belong to Jesus. And that's the essence of what we are sharing with you today. That manifestation is based on relationship. It's based on relationship. By our relationship with Jesus, we manifest. You cannot hold back. You are the light of the world. You will shine. You will shine. You should shine. You should shine. You should shine. And so when we take this communion, wherever you are, you can just take the communion elements that were brought to you. If you don't have it, take bread or take biscuits. Take some Vimto or some what? Orange juice or some Calipo or water. I like the water one. Because out of water came the good wine. So when you declare on the water. You will drink some water you haven't drank before. But on the night he was betrayed, he did this. He said, as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. As we do this, we are climaxing our anniversary and stepping into manifestation, because the height of it is our relationship with him. It is not some impartation. No. It is what is within us that is going out, that is shining forth. That is it. So wherever you are, please come and share. Father, we pray over these elements that as they receive them, and we pray also that all those who are joining us in spirit across the miles in different countries, whatever they are using as tokens, because you've reminded us of the essence of this sacrament. Lord, we pray that the wholeness that comes from you, as our bodies are remembered with you, Lord, may we also receive that wholeness. As our bodies and as our souls are knit together with you, as we remember you, Lord, every victory, oh, you won for us at the cross over sickness and shame and pain, we walk in that victory. Lord, as we remember in our spirit man that we belong to you, we no longer live here and walk in fear, but we walk by faith, knowing that we are more than conquerors through Christ who died. We know that we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, that we should show the praises of him who has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. That is the manifestation of the sons and daughters of God. And as we take the sacrament, Lord, we seal it again. We bring it into remembrance. We bring it into renewal. And we bring it into revival. In the mighty name of Jesus. You want to open your elements now. There's a top part for those who have what I have, that has the bread. Jesus will normally break it. So you too can try and break it. The top part. There's a purple part at the top that you need to open. Yeah. And give thanks. And do it in remembrance of him. That same night, he took the cup of blessing that we bless, and said, this is my blood. It represents my blood that was shed. Mo genti na me wonkwa Yesu mo genti na me nyankwa Yesu mo genti na me wonkwa mo genti na me wonkwa. So you just want to drink it. Thank you Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for your confirmation that because we belong to you, as long as we remain in you and we are remembered with you, Lord, the Father will continue to shine like stars. Father, to be the salt of the earth, to be the light of the world, to draw men from darkness into light, to minister the ministry of reconciliation, O God. Father, to make impact in this world for you. And Father, O God, to live in readiness for your coming. Lord, we walk in that manifestation. For all who have joined us, oh God, we are no longer going to talk about it. We are going to live it. We've entered into that new relationship with you. That enhanced relationship. Have your way. And Lord, I release grace right now by reason of the blood. That Father, every stirring in the spiritual, we set it to work right now. A stirring in the spiritual, because that is what will manifest in the physical. Giftings, that they will be stirred up. Purposes, that they will ripen. Father, oh God, assignments, that they will be heeded to and completed. Power, the power, oh God, shall be engaged. The sicknesses of the past, sicknesses that have lingered in our families, will be a thing of the past. That we are walking in victory, walking in grace, and taking territories for you. We again thank you, oh God, for 2 years of faithfulness, but more so for the greater works ahead. Lord, we know we are blessed, and we thank you for your word. We thank you that every jar has been filled with wine today, and our jars, oh God, are rising. They are picking up shape, oh God, and beginning to serve royalty. We will not be used for the regular. We shall be used for the supernatural. And these testimonies shall follow us, even now and always, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Power and might. We want to celebrate the Lord. Belongs to our God. Dead forever and ever. It's a good time to take a seat. Power and might. Belongs to our God. We want to take something special for our anniversary, for what the Lord has done. You want to give by faith into the new realm that you've entered. On the screens, you will see the merchant code 234234 or the mobile money number. So we can make your donation right now to the Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Forever and ever. Amen, amen. Blessings
and glory.
Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We are grateful. It's not been by our good works, even our faithfulness, no. It's been your mercy and your grace. So we walk in it, and we are grateful. We are grateful. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Amen. If you think this is something, I want to tell you that it hasn't stopped. Right after here, the kids are going to continue. And when the kids are done, we're going to take a short break. And at 4 p.m., we'll release Yaba. If you understand what the word Yaba means, it means we have come. Yaba yedim. We are manifesting. So at 4, we release it. Wherever you are, just share it, make noise, declare. Yeah. And then at 6, get everybody especially the sick. Especially the sick. Those who are sick in the body, sick in the head, sick in the heart, sick everywhere. Let them plug into the night of virtue. For virtue shall go forth. Amen. So let's end with our manifest song and then effectively service is over. Amen. Wherever you are, just rise on your feet. At home, let's manifest. Hallelujah. God bless you, Lydia. You want to appreciate her? That's such a powerful teaching. So the words are on the screen for those of you who are hearing for the first time. It's our theme song for the year, I Shall Manifest. Woo! Let's go.
I had my share of suffering.
Woo!
And I have been preserved. Now, patiently awaiting.
Glory.
Glory and freedom is prepared. I've had my share of suffering,
and
I have been preserved.
Now,
patiently awaiting.
Woo!
Glory and freedom is prepared.
I shall manifest.
Manifest glory. Oh.
Wow, so surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives as we continually dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. One good news is that tonight, Ankla too is joining me. It's going to be something else here. So don't miss 6 p.m., 4 p.m., get some data. We are going to do social media storm. Put Yaba there and then we take off. It's going to be powerful. God bless you all for coming and we love you.